All right, so here we are in Fabric Data Pipelines. I have a example data pipeline to just replicate the creation of files in an ADLS storage account. Within this pipeline, you see I have a single copy activity. My source is looking at sample data. So anyone with a Fabric trial or Fabric capacity can follow along with this video. My source sample data set is the diabetes parquet. There's not much data within this data set, so you'll see kind of how I replicate breaking this out in the mini files. The destination tab, I'm pointing to my storage account, ADLS storage account. My file path is just my container landing zone. I am pulling over Parquet files, and the real magic on how to like kind of break this out into mini files is gonna be ex by expanding the advanced properties field. And down here in the max rows per file, I just kind of selected 50 there, so I can get about 9 files, I think. If we navigate over to my Microsoft Azure Storage Explorer, we see that we are in my landing zone. And this is just an example of those, what, nine files, I think 9 files that I've thrown in here. I've also thrown in this .png just to show you that the last modified date is for like 2 days ago. So the idea is that when a new file comes in here, on creation, this last modified date actually gets set to the creation date, and that's what we're going to be leveraging. So let's go ahead and kick off this data pipeline and generate some sample files. Go to the output, be queued in progress, and we'll just smash refresh 1,000 times. Once this is complete, I'll come back and show you guys. Okay, so after 15 seconds, we're able to run this copy data activity to move over the diabetes sample data into my ADLS storage account, specifically the landing zone container. If we look at the output, we see that we read one file and we wrote out 9 files, just 442 rows. Let's navigate back to the Storage Explorer. You're only going to see the 9 files again because it is using, or I think it will be using the same file name, but we'll see in a sec. Yeah, okay, so it did use the same file name, so it just overwrote the existing files in here. However, as you can see, the last modified date has been updated to February 14th around 10:54 a.m. Eastern Time. In Eastern Time, that's important because later on we're going to be working out of UTC. So we'll get started on the pipeline to actually be able to look at the storage account, identify the new files that were created during some window of time, and then be able to action on that. So let me navigate back to my Fabric workspace. And here is the data pipeline that we're going to be looking at that replicates kind of the storage event trigger that, if you're familiar with our past offerings like Azure Data Factory and Synapse Analytics, you're familiar that those triggers run or will invoke a pipeline or many pipelines when a new file lands. So if we take a look at this pipeline, I've tried to make it dynamic for everyone. In the way that you can kind of specify parameters based on your scenario. So you might not be looking at a container. Your source storage account location might be a container in a directory within that container. So I've allowed you to specify the file system, which is a required parameter. But then we also have this other parameter, pstring directory. So this is going to be the path to the folder in which you are looking for new file creations at, or those events. The premise of this data pipeline is that you're going to set the frequency of the schedule as a parameter as well, because we're effectively going to calculate a historical date timestamp to look back and say, hey, were any files created in the last 10 minutes, right? So that 10 minutes that you're looking back on is going to correlate to the schedule that you have on this Fabric data pipeline. So by going to the Schedule tab up here, if we turn on the schedule, if we select on with the scheduled run, we select frequency by minutes. If I do 10 right here, so this pipeline's going to run every 10 minutes on a schedule, I want my pint schedule frequency parameter to also be 10, because this pipeline's going to run, and then or the schedule is going to invoke this pipeline, and then the logic within the pipeline is going to look back and say, hey, what was 10? What was a date timestamp 10 minutes ago? Okay, now I'm going to look at the storage account and say, are any of these files in the storage account location that we're looking at, were they created in this time window or in the last 10 minutes? So let's go ahead and cancel out of here. The first thing we want to do when this pipeline runs is going to be actually calculating that time, right? So because we don't want to have any latency, the first thing that when this schedule runs this pipeline, we want to capture that moment in time. So that's how we're going to start off with a set variable. I do have a few variables, two arrays, v array files, v the final list of files. So this is just for kind of logging, as well as a v string modified date time start. So that's what we calculate in this first set variable right here. If we select on the set variable and we go to the settings tab, we can look that we have dynamic expression kind of outlined here. So let's go ahead and open up the expression builder. And what we're doing is we're adding to the current UTC time by the frequency or that parameter frequency that we put in. And we're multiplying. You see we have a mul or MUL to multiply that frequency that was provided in the parameter by -1 so that we're effectively subtracting minutes rather than adding minutes. That's because the sub minutes isn't a built-in function. However, we can replicate that by just specifying a multiplication of -1. And we're just going to cast that as a string. So now that we have that variable set, the real kind of magic of this pipeline lives within the get metadata activity. The get metadata activity is an awesome activity. You can go down here and it allows us to kind of get some metadata of some system or something that we're pointing to. In this case, we're pointing to that storage account, the ADLS storage account, and we're looking at the file path in the file directory. So these are leveraging the parameters that we specified. Again, the file system parameter is required because this file path file system field is a required field. So here we're just referencing that parameter that was passed in. In our case, we're looking at landing zone. However, if you have a subdirectory, like you're looking at like dim customer, or you know, HR/dim customer or something like that, you might want to specify a directory path. So this is just allowing you to specify the path, but if you specify nothing, it's just going to default to an empty string and it'll just ignore this field. So let's go ahead and cancel out of that. Really, we're just caring about the file format being binary. We don't care what type of file, because it is a storage account. It can hold blobs. It can hold any type of file. If you notice, if you remember earlier in the video, I showed you that .png, just showing that you can trigger on, or this process will work for any file type. Now, in the field list, the get metadata has many different field lists, especially, and it definitely depends on if you're looking at a folder, like we are here, or container folder, or a file name. So you will see different arguments depending on if you have the file name field filled out or not. However, we don't, we're leaving that blank. And our options are going to be child items. We can look if something exists, the name of the child item, the item type, so it'd be like folder or file, and then last modified. Last modified is going to be our key field that we're interested in, but we don't necessarily need to return it in the output of the get metadata. However, I left it in here just for logging purposes, so I can just validate that, hey, this file that we returned, or this list of files, they all match the date range that I'm expecting, or that I've specified. Now, the key to make this work is by expanding this advanced field down here. And we have the option or the property filter by last modified. And we have a start time in UTC. So it's very important. So this is going to say, hey, the Git metadata, go look at my ADLS storage account in this location and give me a list of child items that were created or last modified since this start time. Right, so very important. And this is just referencing that variable, the vstring modified date time start, which we calculated earlier. So this is going to look back at the time. Remember, this variable is dependent on that parameter. We set the pint scheduled frequency. We have it set to 3. And then this number, again, should match your scheduled frequency by minutes. Okay. You can modify this if you need to do by hour or whatever. But in this example, we're just doing it by minutes. So just key point, this number matches that schedule. And it's calculated in this set variable. This is going to return a date time stamp. We're then leveraging that date timestamp down here in the Git metadata advanced section under filter by last modified start date. Now, just for the purposes of showing that we can capture each file, I'm going to just throw the output of the Git metadata into a for each loop. And then for each file returned, we're going to just iterate and we're going to build an array or hydrate an array of those file names. Because the append array, which is what we're using right here, activity doesn't show you like the full kind of array or the array at that point in time. I have a set variable activity outside of the for each loop that's just setting the array that we're setting inside the for each loop to a new array. So we just get that consolidated list of file names. In a real world scenario, you would probably have a copy data activity or any of your business logic or data or your ETL kind of logic within this for each loop. It could be like invoke another pipeline. You could be looking at the file name and routing that to a different process or just moving that file over to like your Lakehouse files section. This demo is just to say, hey, we were able to get the new files. We have that list of, you know, we can iterate or enumerate over that list of file names, and I can capture each of those file names by using item.name kind of keyword there. So if we go back to our Storage Explorer, if I hit refresh, just again, we hydrated this at 10:54. That was about, 10 minutes ago. I'm going to just kick that off again so that we get a new list of files in that storage account. And then I'm going to run this. Let's just do 15 minutes. We're doing live demo here. We'll do 15 minutes. We'll do 20. I'm bad at math. 20. Let's save this. And then let's go ahead and run this pipeline and kind of show you the output. So again, we're going to get prompted with the pipeline run parameters. Those look good to me. Let's go ahead and kick this off. Navigate to the output tab and hit refresh. So the for each loop, one side note in the settings, the for each loop, you can have it set to sequential. So it will enumerate one at a time, or you can kind of enable some concurrency by disabling sequential, then having everything set to a batch count. So important note here, batch count will look like this when you first create it, but it's really defaulting to 20. And the max value you can have in here is 50. So essentially, if I have 50 files, it's going to run 50 of these append variable or append array activities all at the same time. So if you're doing like data movement, if you do sequential and like there's a copy activity in here, it'll run one copy activity after the other, or each loop will run a single copy activity. However, if you crank this up to 50, you could potentially have 50 copy activities all running in parallel, effectively, 50xing your data movement. So let's go back to the output. Here's the example of the output. Again, the first thing we did was set the vstring modified date time start. If we look here, the input was set, or the output, doesn't really matter with a set variable, was set to February 14th, 2024 at 1546. Again, this is in UTC time. So we captured that date time, and then we did a get new file. So this is our metadata, and the input of that, actually, if we're going to expand the input, and we can see that the modified, the store settings, modified date time start, is that value that we calculated earlier and that we passed in. So just showing you that we are using that value, and that's the input to the get metadata activity. Let's go ahead and exit out of here and look at the output of the get metadata activity. So if we expand this output, so we output last modified, so it looks like last modified of the container. But for each child item, we now have this child items value, which is an array of JSON objects. So each child item represents each of the files that are in my storage account. So I'm going to navigate back to storage, and you can see each of these are represented in this output.childItems of the get metadata activity. Now you have the ability to iterate. So get metadata output.childItems. So we're going to enumerate over that array of child items. All right, so we're enumerating over this array. And for each one of those, and we did this in parallel, we're going to hydrate that array. And just for each file name, looks like the input, each file name we are appending to that array. So at the very end, after the for each loop, so again, in here you would most likely have a copy data activity or some other logic to route to a different ETL process. But at the very end, we're just getting that list, that full list of files. So let's go ahead and look at set v array final file list, hit expand, and there's our the new files that created. And you can see that we only have the files that were last modified. We did not pick up this existing file that was in a later date. So I hope that was helpful. I do have a blog that's coming out soon that's going to step-by-step kind of show you how to build this pipeline. You know, please leave a comment, you know, consider subscribing, and welcome to the backlog. Thank you.